Today's episode of This Week in Startups is brought to you by Citrix Sharefile, secure file transfer built for business. Visit sharefile.com, click on the microphone, and enter Twist for a free 30-day trial. And by Squarespace, an all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create a professional website, and now an online store. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase on new accounts, go to squarespace.com and use the offer code TWIST. And by AWS Activate, the Amazon Web Services startup program. It's easy to start and scale your business with AWS. Visit aws.amazon.com/activate.
Hey, everybody, this is going to be an amazing episode, and you're going to love it. On today's episode, we talk about the nuances of crowdfunding with smart luggage creator Brian Chen. This is an amazing episode where you actually see a founder who is about to put their product on Indiegogo. And in fact, that product was just put on yesterday. Additionally, this founder has four other co-founders. He's running a company with five co-founders. So at the end of this episode, about 45 minutes in, we've added a startup basics that answers the question, should you have a co-founder, yes or no? And I answer this question in detail. This is an amazingly educational episode that you're going to want to watch twice. That's my prescription for you, founders. Watch it twice. Stick with us.
It's what it's all about, man. They said money is the root of all evil. How it feeds my people. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you. Yeah. Money is the root of all evil. Funny how it feeds my people. Yeah. We ain't gonna live like equals until we get the money, spend the money, and defeat you.
Hey, everybody, welcome to This Week in Startups. It's your host, Jason Calacanis, and this is the show where we talk about startup companies. Now, one of the biggest phenomenons in entrepreneurship in 2012 to, you know, now 2014 when we're taping this, has been crowdfunding. This has been an amazing revolution. What is crowdfunding? Crowdfunding is pre-sales. That's all it is. It's pre-selling stuff. Now, why is pre-selling so important? Well, pre-selling is so important, I believe, for two reasons. One, it forces the entrepreneur to have clarity as to what they are building. And two, it tests the market in the ultimate way by taking money from people without actually giving them the product. This has led to an amount of purity in the world of entrepreneurship that I've never seen. Typically, people would take a bunch of money from their friends and family and build some schlocky piece of garbage and then show it to everybody, and everybody would go, oh my God, what a piece of junk. Today, anybody comes to you with a schlocky piece of garbage and a terrible idea, you know what people say? Put it on Kickstarter. You know how I know this? I was asked to meet with some guy who was a musician. And he said to me, Jason, I live up in the mountains. Come see me. So I go up to the mountains and he says, I have this great idea. I want to create a new MP3 player. And I said, listen, Neil Young, rock legend, I am in awe of you. VCs and angel investors are not going to get this. They're not going to give you money to create a new standard for music because, let's face it, VCs and largely angel investors, they're not the most visionary group of people. And although they're supposed to take risks, they generally don't. What you need to do, rock legend, Neil Young, I literally did the bow. I mean, this was like a surreal moment for me. I felt like I'm a 12-year-old kid with my Harvest shirt on, like sitting there with Neil Young. How great is my life? Literally, I'm 12 years old, and all I do is listen to Harvest on repeat for like 3 years of my life. And then 30 years later, I'm hanging out with Neil at his house talking about his startup company. Pinch yourself. And I said, Neil, this is a Kickstarter project. You have so many fans. They trust you. I trust you. The first thing I'm going to do when you put this Pono player online is I'm going to order two. And if you made a one where you sign it, I pay double. And if all your friends, Pearl Jam, Eddie Vedder, and all these people who love and respect you for making some of the greatest music ever recorded, love you so much, Neil Young. They are going to pay an extra $100 because Eddie Vedder wrote Eddie Vedder in a Sharpie. And you can go to Eddie Vedder and say, Eddie, can you sign these 100 so we can make music sound better? And Eddie Vedder is going to go, Neil Young. And he's going to start signing fucking Ponos. Sorry, bleep that out. I want to keep my rating on iTunes. And lo and behold, all the VCs and angels are like, backing something by a celebrity. Like, I'll go to lunch with them. I'm not going to back it. It's kind of scary. Celebrity, rock legends doing startups. He puts it on the interwebs, Kickstarter, Indiegogo. I think it was Kickstarter. And as I, Jason Calacanis, predicted and told Neil Young, this thing went supernova. Even rock legend Neil Young needs to put his product out there to the world in order to validate it. And you know what? That upped Neil Young's game. He really thought about the product. And his team really studied the market because they don't want to put the product out there. It's freaking scary, fracking scary. I'm trying to keep my iTunes rating. iTunes podcasting gods featuring This Week in Startup once a month now on average. Thank you. And even rock legend Neil Young has got to prove himself. And you know what? This has made everybody sharp. The biggest goddamn Kickstarter crowdfunding campaign to date, after Neil Young's, I think, was a goddamn cooler. And I'm not BSing you. Literally, a cooler for going to the beach with beer. This dude, and he's got to be on the show, created a goddamn cooler and sold, I don't know, Emmy award-winning producer Jackie, pull it up. I think like $10 or $15 million worth of coolers. And I want this cooler because it's got a blender built in and this and that. It's amazing. This is the age we live in. Now, a lot of these things don't actually see the light of day. They come out really crummy. They break down. Kickstarter's got its problems. Indiegogo's got its problems. I passed on investing at Indiegogo on a $30 million valuation. I lost at least $10 million. I'm an idiot. All that being said, it's a great way for 10% of the audience to support the new. You guys ever see Ratatouille? Anton Ego? The life of a critic is not very meaningful, but there is one moment when a critic has value. And that is when the critics support the new. The rat making soup, making Ratatouille that shakes Anton Ego to his core. That's the moment. And that's what Kickstarter and Indiegogo and all these crowdfunding sites, AngelList even, let us do. They let us support the new. And that's why I think they're so freaking brilliant and I love them. That's why you love them. Even if the product comes out imperfect, who cares? We're putting something new in the universe. Over $13 million in beer coolers with a $50,000 goddamn goal. I mean, the world has gone crazy. Neil Young has replaced the Sony Walkman. Some insane person who in another lifetime would have been considered the Ralph Cramden of his day with a cockamamie scheme to create Kenneth Core and Apple has sold $13 million in beer coolers. What the hell is going on in this world? I love it. That's what this episode's about. This episode is about insane people making insane products. And I've got one of them here today with a product that I believe will be bigger, sounds crazy, than both Pono and the cooler, the beer cooler. I think this will exceed it. I honestly do. And that's why I asked you to be on the show. So with me is Brian Chen. He is the co-founder of Bluesmart. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
All right. Now you are... Are you like a Ralph Cramden kind of crazy guy who your whole life you came up with crazy ideas and everybody told you you're an idiot? What's your story? Where do you come from? Who are you?
So I'm kind of from all over the place.
See, that's it. That's the Ralph Cramden all right. Over the place. Okay, here we go.
So I split my time growing up between Colorado and Taiwan.
Okay.
And, you know, I've been passionate about entrepreneurship for a really long time.
The Taiwanese are big entrepreneurs, aren't they?
Yeah.
Very entrepreneurial.
Absolutely. Semiconductor industry is huge in Taiwan.
A lot
of really amazing.
The servers all come out of Taiwan, right? All the rack servers that people put up.
Exactly, exactly. The manufacturers of most Apple products are Taiwanese companies. So
interesting. Yeah. You consider Taiwan a separate country than China?
I do.
All right.
I do.
All right. So somebody clip this and send this to the home office in Beijing. No, you do. You consider it a separate country.
I mean, I think de facto it is.
Right.
There's no kind of legal jurisdiction that China has over Taiwan.
They just like to shoot rockets over it sometimes to prove their might.
Exactly.
They do, right? Literally?
Less so now, but in the 90s, in the late 90s, China did, you know, they would do military exercises. And
were you ever there during that?
Yes, I was. But, you know, it was kind of treated as a little bit of a joke. It was never treated super seriously. I mean, obviously, from a diplomatic perspective, it was very serious. Mm. But on the ground, nobody was ever overly concerned about
it. So you're an entrepreneur.
Yes.
And you have you done anything successful in your career yet? How old are you?
I'm 28.
You're 28?
Yeah.
Have you done anything successful? Have you tried some crazy things? How many businesses have you started?
So this is my first one as a co-founder.
Okay.
Last year, I joined a startup. So backing up a little bit, I worked at an organization called Endeavor that backs crazy people in emerging markets. So essentially, we support high-impact entrepreneurs from around the world. And then last year, I ended up joining one of the portfolio companies, which was a Greece-based, you know, digital media firm.
In Athens.
Yes. Yes. So that's crazy, right?
So starting this is, a digital so media. You really are insane. Like you're deciding like, hey, what would be a great place for me to put my entrepreneurial skills, and I'm Greek, to go to Athens, which is on the verge of bankruptcy, to start an ad agency in a market that's absolutely collapsing.
Yeah. I mean, you know, that's the beauty of entrepreneurship, I think. You make opportunity where crisis, where other people see crisis.
Interesting. So you're a risk taker. You join that portfolio company.
Yep.
It implodes, I take it?
It's still going. So
semi implosion.
Yeah. Yep. And It's not imploding.
But so then you decide you're going to do this. You watch all this Kickstarter stuff, and you decide you're going to make the Bluesmart.
Yeah. So we actually have a large founding team. We have 5 co-founders, and you know, we're all travelers. For my last job, or when I was working with Endeavor, I was flying, you know, all the time, and suitcases can become, you know, the source of huge nightmares. You know, they turn beautiful trips into nightmares.
Right.
And we just started thinking that, you know, the luggage industry has been stagnant for decades. Wheels were introduced in the 1970s.
That was the last big innovation with wheels?
Yeah, exactly.
All right. So when we get back from the commercial break, I want you to show my audience the Bluesmart, which is the world's first smart carry-on. When we get back on This Week in Startups. Yes, Citrix Sharefile is an amazing product, and we use it here because sharing files that are important with your coworkers and clients is incredibly important. You want to do it safely, and you want to do it professionally, and that's what Sharefile allows you to do. Contracts, spreadsheets, presentations, photos, all that important stuff. It's very important that they're kept safe, secure, and under your control, and that's why we recommend Citrix Sharefile. It's the easy-to-use business solution that allows you to exchange files quickly and securely of almost any size, and you can do it on your mobile phone. You can do it any way you like. You can do it on your desktop, and you can send files of almost any size. You're not going to get bounce backs, of course. And you can control on a very granular level who has access. You can say, this group of people can read it. This group of people can edit it. This people can move it. One person gets access to this file folder. This person gets access to another. When you're doing document libraries and you're doing a deal room, this is the kind of software you need. When you're sharing important budgets, et cetera, it syncs automatically. So all your team will always have the most updated materials across all devices. And you can access Citrix Sharefile from anywhere, laptop, tablet, smartphone, as I said. Okay, so if you want to go and try Sharefile, you have a special offer. Sign up today and you'll receive a 30-day free trial, no obligation. Go to sharefile.com, click on the radio microphone button at the top of the homepage, and enter Twist. Remember, visit sharefile.com, radio microphone button at the top, and type in Twist. Sharefile.com, microphone button, Twist. Please go do that. Please try this awesome software. And thank you so much to Citrix Sharefile for sponsoring This Week in Startups. We truly appreciate it. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to This Week in Startups. I'm your host, Jason Calacanis. You can find me on the Twitter at Jason. Go ahead and just type at Jason. Hey, I love at TWI Startups or at Jason. Why don't you have at whoever on the show? You know, whatever. Just talk to me on Twitter and talk to the show at TWI Startups. You can talk to Emmy Award-winning producer Jackie or Jacob. Just brilliant people producing the show. All right. On the show today, Brian Chen, who is the co-founder of Bluesmart, which is the world's first smart luggage. So you decide to make smart luggage.
That's right.
And I have it here. This is the prototype.
Correct.
And you're going to launch the Indiegogo any day now. And in fact, whenever this show comes out, it's going to be the day that this comes out.
Right.
You're gonna kick the Indiegogo off right after we turn on, or the same moment we turn on the show, right?
So October 20th, 9 a.m. Eastern time.
October 20th, 9. So we're gonna have the show out by then, right, Jackie? We're gonna do it at the same time. So we're like the launching partner of this. I have no financial interest in this. Okay, here we go. So what is this? And why is it special?
So it's a suitcase that gives the modern day traveler peace of mind.
Right? Okay.
So suitcases haven't changed, but the needs of the modern traveler have. What that means is there's a built-in battery that lets you recharge your phone up to six times.
So that's like a dark energy, like level battery, like a really hardcore battery.
Right, right.
And so I see here this is the USB cable.
So that'll be more kind of integrated into the actual suitcase. So somewhere
there'll be a little USB port on the outside maybe, or still on the inside of the
pouch? On the outside.
On the outside.
Yeah.
So on the outside, just plug in, boom, and you can charge your phone six times.
Yes.
And I'm assuming that battery could be put in for a 12-hour one or a 24-hour one or something, right?
Right, right. The first one that we're putting in is going to let you charge it six times.
Six times for an average phone. So that's like a battery pack that's like this big, right?
Yep.
But there's nothing that says you couldn't put a double one in.
Exactly.
Like a real road warrior.
We could do that.
So that's awesome right there, built in. And I've seen that before. Like there's a purse that has a clutch that has a battery in it, right?
Right.
Okay. So what's the next most important feature? Battery power, everybody loves that. What would you say, is that the number one feature?
No. So basically—
What's the number one feature?
You know, basically we've built in a computer into the suitcase.
Where's the computer?
So it's in the top piece. It's right below the handle.
Okay, right below the handle here. Yeah. Okay. So there's a computer under here somewhere. And what does that computer do?
So it connects to your smartphone.
Okay, by?
Via Bluetooth.
Okay, Bluetooth low energy.
Yep.
So that's using that battery in here.
Yes.
So the same battery pack is powering that.
Yep.
How long does it power that computer?
So
approximately,
if you weren't charging your phone, then it would last up to 2 months.
Wow. Okay. So you can set it and forget it. Now you have a computer in here. What is it? A Raspberry Pi?
It's a PCBA. So it's a printed circuit board.
Got it. You made that PCBA?
Yes. Okay. Yes, we did.
PCB.
So it's a printed circuit board assembly.
Assembly. Got it. Okay.
Right,
PCBA.
Right.
You got a PCBA. And then what does that cost to make?
I mean, when you mass produce it, it'll be about
$5. $5.
But then the real investment is in kind of designing the layout.
Got
and
it.
Designing the
what
the
operating
components.
System does that PCBA run?
So there's firmware.
I see.
Right. So the firmware we've also developed.
Got
and,
it. Okay.
Yeah.
So this is a very light operating system, as
exactly.
it were.
Exactly.
And what does that Bluetooth, when it connects to your phone, what does it enable you to do?
So it lets you do a lot of things. So it lets you.
What's the number one thing?
Well, the thing that most people get excited about is that it tracks your location.
Got it.
So there's a GPS module inside of the suitcase.
Really?
That lets you identify, you know, where in the world it is.
Got it. So I can lock this too. I bought it. It's got a nice flap here.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, wow. So, it just clicks right in. Boom, beautiful. Okay. So you know where your suitcase is at all times because it's a GPS tracker in here.
Exactly.
Do you need to have a subscription to a GPS service to do that?
No.
To send it back? How does it get my location back to my phone?
Via Bluetooth.
So if my Bluetooth connection and it's on the plane, if I ship this somewhere, it's not pinging a server. So if I am, if my bag goes to another city and it gets out of reach of my phone, I don't know where my thing is.
Right. So it's a little bit like some of the other products on the market where there's a network of devices out there. So if another Bluesmart user were to be in proximity to the suitcase, then that information would be transmitted. Essentially, there's kind of the lost mode
that
you can turn on your phone. Yeah.
Okay. So that's pretty interesting. If I am within range, and how far is the Bluetooth range?
In
an airport.
Probably around 90 feet.
90 feet. So if my suitcase separates from me, what happens?
There's a proximity alert. So if you forget it, you know, your suitcase and leave it behind by accident, then you'll get a little pop-up on your phone that says, oh, you've left me behind.
Got it. So if I go to the bathroom, I leave my roller, people have done before, leave it at Starbucks, the restaurant, I get 15 feet away, 20 feet away, and then it all of a sudden an alarm goes off.
So you can actually set the distance that you want it to set off. But yeah, that's the idea.
So in an airport, it'd be 15 feet or something, 20 feet. So if I go 20 feet away, or more importantly, I take a nap and somebody walks away with my thing, an alarm goes off on my phone.
Exactly.
Does an alarm go off on here? Is there a speaker and an alarm?
No.
What did you think about they were doing that?
Not really.
Oh, I want a screeching alarm to go off on that thing. Scare the bejesus out of the people in the baggage container. Okay, so it knows. So I know where it is on a map.
You know where it is on a map. You can lock and unlock it digitally from your phone.
Got it.
And the lock that we're that we have in there is going to be TSA approved. So, you know, you're totally under regulation.
Got
when
it.
You, if you need to check it in.
How did that TSA lock work? Is there like a standard key that opens everything?
Exactly.
And then closes everything?
Yes.
Do you have one of those keys?
I do not.
Do they sell those keys like in Taiwan in a market? Like, can you get those anywhere?
Absolutely
on eBay or anything like that, you think?
Absolutely not.
So if I do an eBay or like a Baidu or some crazy Craigslist search, I'm not going to find one of those TSA keys?
No.
But it's not like meant to be like, you're not going to put $100,000 in here and expect it to be secure. People can crack open any of these kind of suitcases.
Right, right. It gives you, you know.
Light security.
Exactly, exactly. And that's usually what you need. You know, it's a deterrent to from someone just opening your suitcase and taking something out.
Ah, got it. So what else is in here now? Oh, show me the app. You have some of these things on the app, right?
Yeah,
so show me some of the screenshots on the app. Let's pull those up here and we'll take a look. Take a look-ski.
So essentially, here's the lock.
Okay, pulling it up right now. All right. Well, that's beautiful looking. It's like Instagram for your luggage. Let's see here. For those of you watching, it says, "Hi, Tom," and then there is a fashion model. Very interestingly, the first customer of the Bluesmart is a stock photo model. It's
right.
Interesting that the first person to buy was a stock photo model. But
so the other thing is that you can lift the handle.
Ooh.
And it tells you the weight.
That's fascinating. So it's got, because you know, we just bought something on eBay, not eBay, Amazon, which you hook onto your luggage and you pull it up. You know why I bought that?
Why?
Because literally every time I go on vacation with my wife, we have, this is the largest amount of marital discord I have in my marriage.
Mm-hmm.
When we go, I always say, this weighs too much. She says, no, it does not. We get there.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm checking the luggage, the person at the desk is like, it's over, but it's okay. But if she checks it, they're like, it's over. You have to remove stuff. I don't know what it is about like the hostility, like towards her or whatever. I don't know. Women get like, maybe white dudes get a pass and Asian women don't. But
so yeah, airlines have the option to force check your bag if your carry on weighs too much.
Yeah. So
this
lets
you
know.
Tell you if it's underneath the.
I love that. So that's just a sensor in there. Boom.
Yep, it's a load sensor underneath the.
So genius.
The handle.
Love it. That's by the way the best feature I think so far.
So you can lock and unlock it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a digital lock, so basically.
Right. Oh, I see. Here you go. Boom. So it just looks like the August or whatever. If you've seen that,
right?
You just press a button, lock and unlock. It's very
exactly.
cool.
And then, of course, you can charge your batteries. And actually, we have two
and
USB
you got
ports.
Oh, so there'll be two USB ports, and you have a battery status.
Yes.
So, what is this going to cost?
So on Indiegogo, the beginning price will be $195.
Too cheap. I mean, I like it. It's just too cheap. Like, I can buy one of these rollers from Briggs & Riley,
right?
Which is the best luggage company, by the way. You know Briggs & Riley?
Of course, of course.
Briggs & Riley is the greatest company. I'm going to do a commercial for Briggs & Riley right now. They're not a sponsor of the show. They goddamn should be, because I have literally 50 of my friends have bought Briggs & Riley. You know what the thing about Briggs & Riley is? Do you know why they're so popular?
I think it's a lot of it is easy access to.
No. The guarantee. Mm-hmm. Anything breaks on Briggs & Riley, they replace it immediately. So you just send it to them and they fix it for life. If you bought the Briggs & Riley bag off of eBay used and it breaks, it rips, you just send it to them and fix it.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. But my roller from Briggs & Riley is the same like when I think it's about $300 or $400 without any electronics.
Right.
So how did you come to a $195 price point? That seems too cheap.
Well, so on Indiegogo, you know, we know that the people who back this project are taking a risk because they're getting the product is still under development. It's going to be we're going to fulfill in a couple of months, but they're essentially backing it ahead of time. So
mm-hmm, yeah,
there's going to be a heavy discount, and this is true for you know.
So what is the retail price going to be then?
It'll be about $450.
Whoa! Now you jumped the fence.
So Tumi suitcases will be $600 and above.
Remoa, for a small one?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought that was $600. Really, a Tumi is $600 for a
and
roller.
And Remoa will be, you know, $800.
Who?
Remoa.
What is Remoa?
It's
how do you spell that?
Rimowa.
Riow.
Rim.
Rimowa. Wow, there you go. Remoa. I've never even heard of this.
So a lot of travelers like Remoa as well.
It's good looking, but they're expensive, you're saying.
Yeah. And a lot of business.
Oh, these are those aluminum ones, right?
No, they're, you know, they use, they're plastic.
Ah.
They're polycarbonate.
Got it. And what do you think? Those polycarbonate hard ones, are they better or worse than like getting the canvas, tough canvas ones?
So we decided to essentially combine hard cases with soft case. Mm. So we have both. We're actually using a three-layer polycarbonate as well for our suitcase. And then the soft shell on the outside, the soft exterior is for easy access to your electronics. So if you just have a hard case, then you can't do that.
Got it. Yeah, I do love this. This feature is great. Look at this over here on the over-the-shoulder camera, Jacob. You can just slide your laptop in and out, so it's almost like a backpack. I think I would buy it just for that feature. I think that's killer. I've never seen that one. Maybe Ramoa has that or something. But so then you think $450 with the public.
That's what we're currently thinking.
All right, when we get back from this commercial break, let's talk a little bit about what you expect when this goes out and what the 2.0 might look like when we get back on This Week in Startups. Ah, yes, Squarespace, 24-hour support for exceptional-looking websites. I've been using Squarespace for years. It's a wonderful product. It's flawless. If you want to build a beautiful, professional-looking website, literally, you don't need to hire a designer. You don't need to get servers. You don't need to install software. And you don't need to become beholden to some weird person who builds websites for companies for a living. No. What you do, I just went to Bryce and I was like, Bryce, the fund needs a website. He literally came back to me 2 days later and I look at the website. I was like, this is a website that would have cost $100,000 to build. I didn't even have to ask him how he did it. He just sent me the password. I click, I log in, I see, oh, here's the 7 pages in the CMS. Boom, I'm going to edit the pages. I was like, oh, you know what? We need the portfolio companies on there. Boom, he comes back in half an hour, 50 portfolio companies' logos are up and running. I was like, oh, we need a schedule for this. We need that. All these features just get added and they constantly improve Squarespace, but they keep the price the same. So this is the beauty of software as a service. What happens is a company like Squarespace provides a service like hosting a professional website that's beautifully designed, and then mobile phones become big. So instead of charging you and redesigning your website and saying, I need $3,000 to make a mobile website, it's going to take 2 months, they have a team of professionals who go build all the website templates as responsive. And hundreds of thousands of Squarespace companies now have mobile websites. You don't even have to worry about it. Then everybody wants commerce. Boom, all of a sudden they have shopping carts and commerce. They just keep doing this over and over again. They invest, they make more features, and people never leave the service. I literally have dozens and dozens of event websites and websites we use here, and I never turn off Squarespace. I keep using it and using it, and we've become an amazing client for them, and they've been an amazing, amazing partner for us. Squarespace 7 makes things even easier while keeping the power and complexity of the Squarespace platform. So it's simpler, but it still has, it's elegantly simple yet complex is how I would say it. And if you're getting started, it's super easy to navigate. You can use Google Apps to directly get into your account, and email is easy to set up, fully integrated, blah, 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 blah. You know how it works. It's amazing. It's everything you need to create an exceptional website. Only $8 a month, no credit card required. Go ahead and visit squarespace.com. And if you want to keep it, use the promo code TWIST. Use the promo code TWIST. And everybody say thank you to at Squarespace. Sell products, take donations, awesome new templates. Everything is working great over there at Squarespace. It's a phenomenal company. I give it my highest recommendation. You will love it. Thank you, Squarespace. All right, let's get back to this amazing episode. Hey, welcome back to the show. Today, my guest is Brian Chen. He is Taiwanese Boulder. Boulder or?
Denver.
Denver.
Yeah.
Denver Taiwanese entrepreneur who has co-founded Bluesmart, which is now on Indiegogo. Go to Indiegogo.com and just search for Bluesmart, or just do Get Bluesmart on your Twitter. And what's your website?
Bluesmart.com.
Bluesmart.com. And this is smart luggage. It's got a little computer in it. It's got Bluetooth. It's got sick battery life. You can charge your phone. It's got a really beautiful a locking system you can unlock from your phone. It's got a weight scale on the handle.
Yep.
I think that's everything, right?
And proximity alerts.
And the proximity alerts, right. You know the distance.
And our mobile app, I forgot to mention, it actually lets you see all of your travel history. So,
oh, that's nice.
You know, you get to know, oh, this suitcase has traveled X number of miles.
And, ah. So if I gave this to somebody, it'd be like a little bit of a spy thing. I give it to as a gift to somebody. Don't tell them it's in there. I could track them. Maybe some James Bond stuff. No, because you'd have to be connected to a smartphone.
Exactly.
All right, so this is the feature that makes me bummed out about this. I wanted to have an independent GPS and internet connection because I want to have it sending me a ping of where it is at all times. Because when I ship it or I'm not at my hotel, I want to know where my bag is. And if my bag leaves my hotel room when I'm not at the hotel, I want to know that it opened. And I want a camera in there to take a picture of when it opens. So when the TSA opens this bad boy, I want it to start recording with a secret camera. I want to know who's been opening and closing this thing. Now, these two crazy features would add a lot of cost. And you must have considered them in your crazy brainstorming meetings, being the crazy entrepreneur you are.
No, absolutely. We did consider these things. You know, we don't think that users would be willing to pay a subscription fee. So if you had a cellular module in there, you'd have to pay, you know, $5, $10 a month to be able to ping the servers.
$5 a month from like something like, what, AT&T Whisper Network or something like that?
Exactly, something like that.
That's what like the Kindles do, right? And they, or the, yeah, your Kindle does that, right? They have like a but they include it in the price of the Kindle.
Well, so I mean, if you get an iPad that has 3G, then you need to pay a data fee, you know, subscription fee as well.
But there's a this would be a light amount of data, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be very light, but you would still have
to pay. So you looked into it?
Yeah.
How much would it be for 2 years of data? Or would, if you got like a bulk deal or something like that, or
how much would you pay? It would be about, well, I think what we found was about $5 to $10 per month.
Wow.
Because the other thing is if you travel internationally, you need to have relationships with it. All carriers kind of internationally.
Right.
So.
I wonder if you could have it where it went to any open Wi-Fi network and just tried to join them and send the ping data. So if your thing did get stolen and got jacked, it would be recording that whole time. And then if it happened to find an open Wi-Fi network, it then uploaded.
Right.
The images of who stole it and the GPS tracking for the entire life of it.
Well, I think the idea is as travel becomes a more connected experience, then you do have a density of all these different devices, whether they're suitcases or iBeacons or—
What do you call that, a mesh network or something?
Yeah.
What do you call that ad hoc network of all these devices in the world?
Yeah, you could call it a mesh network.
And you would have to have a large number of customers having this, and then I would send your—if I was— in Denver airport and you were going to New York and they sent your luggage to Denver and I happened to be with, you know, my suitcase, mine would pick up yours as well because you would be beaconing that information?
Yeah, you would have to turn on to like a loss mode, but yes.
So if you turn on loss mode, how does loss mode get onto this device?
So it's basically whether the, like when it's scanning, like whether or not it displays is something that we can control. That's basically the way it works.
Yeah. So, but how would you turn it on if I'm not connected to it? Does it go on automatically after some period of time? Lost, it becomes lost or if I don't connect in 24 hours or something?
No. So you'd still turn it on. You would turn it on your phone. But basically, because someone else is using their phone.
Got it.
So they are connected to our servers and they can kind of know what to look for. So we can tell, we basically tell what.
How do you deal with the privacy issue of that? Like, because if my phone can pick up all the other Bluesmart luggage.
Right.
And then send it back, my phone is picking up that, oh, hey, Brian and Jason's luggage is at this airport.
So, I mean, privacy is definitely very important to us.
Yeah.
First, there's a password that connects, that allows the sync. So that's the first kind of layer of protection. And then in terms of storing the data, we're complying with all of the industry standards.
So you're encrypting everything on the server side or whatever.
Right. Exactly.
So what is your expectation when you put this out there, having seen the cooler, the beer cooler do so well? What do you think is going to happen? Do you think this could outsell that? Do you think it's going to sell half that? I mean, what is your goal and do you think you're going to hit it?
I mean, our funding goal is $50,000. We think that we're definitely going to hit that. We built this product because we want to use it and we think that there are a lot of other people out there like us. So we think it could really blow up, but these can be tough to. We would love for it to sell more than the.
You only have to sell 250 to hit that $50,000 goal, or something to that effect, right?
Right.
So, what is it going to cost to manufacture?
So the 195 will basically cover our manufacturing and distribution costs and our, you know, quality assurance and
so you're selling them at break even or a slight loss?
Exactly.
How much money have you invested so far to get to this prototype and get it ready for Indiegogo? What do you have to spend in 2014 to launch like an Indiegogo level product?
Yeah. So we I would say that we're fairly far along in our product development when it comes to launching, because we already have a prototype that was built by our manufacturers. You know, so we've moved past the 3D printing and the Arduino kind of prototyping phase, and we have so taking that into account. You know, we raised a small seed round earlier in the year to build the prototype out and
250, 500.
300,000.
300,000. So it took you about $300,000 or so to get to launch, or half that amount.
About half, yeah. To get to launch and then having, you know, marketing assets available for the campaign.
And what, 6 months, a year? How long, how much time in addition to the 150,000?
About a year.
About a year.
Yeah.
So this has been under
a little bit less than a year.
A little bit, so maybe 9, 10 months of work. $150,000. And if you get $250,000 in orders, you got 1,000 orders or something like that. And what's the step after that? What comes next after you get all that money?
So the phase between prototyping to fulfillment, you know, there's still going to be a lot of work to be done.
What is that?
The quality. Work? So we're going to, you know, make sure that the quality is up to the standards that we want, which is, you know, very high quality. We still need to do a lot of work on the mobile app. On the software development side. And then, you know, we're going to start thinking about what kind of products do we want to build out. You know, I think part of the great thing, as you were saying, about crowdfunding campaigns is you get a lot of immediate user feedback. And we are going to be listening to our users and, you know, we're going to iterate on the product according to that feedback.
Interesting. So does Indiegogo give you the $250,000 the second the campaign completes? They just ship you the money?
It does need to there's a clearing process at the very end. Yeah.
At the very end. But then you just get this huge chunk of cash, right?
Right.
Now, there have been a bunch of implosions and fraud and other things on Indiegogo. They claim they're just a platform connecting creators and consumers, which seems reasonable to me. But I think a lot of consumers feel like, well, Indiegogo is more like saying Target or Amazon, even though Indiegogo to me is more like saying AngelList, like, you know, we're backing a dream kind of a thing. How do you deal with that perception that the public believes you're selling a refined, complete product when in fact you're selling a vision of a product that, let's face it, is only 30% realized? 40% realized?
I would say much farther along than that.
Okay, 60% realized?
Say, yeah, it's hard to assign a percentage, but maybe 80 or 90%.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
So you feel you're 80, 90%.
Yeah.
But so you don't feel there's a major issue for you in dealing with this perception issue?
Well, so we're also trying to be as honest as possible with our users, right? So we're being very transparent with where we are. We're showing photos of the actual prototype on our page. And one of our co-founders actually recently moved to Hong Kong to oversee production. So we are fully committed to making this the, you know, conform to the vision that we are portraying and being as transparent as possible. That's basically the way that we're approaching it.
Awesome. Well, listen, I think it's going to be a huge success. I really want, I want to pay $100 more and get a data plan in there. Like one of those low data plans, which I think would make it just super epic to know where your luggage is at any time. But I guess there are services where you can get like a little chip or something and throw it in there. But I really think putting a little camera in there to store, like those cameras are super cheap, right? Like when you, like what's that one called? The narrative that you can click,
right?
You know, it takes a picture every 2 seconds. I think that would be the dopest thing. You gotta, what about the camera? You guys thinking about doing that in the 2.0?
We'll see what the user feedback is.
But you guys talked about it.
We did.
You left it out.
We left it out.
But why?
You know, I think
privacy or cost? I mean, because that doesn't cost that much. It'd be like $5 more, maybe $10 more, right? Or just complexity or what?
I think we're trying to sell a customer experience, and I think that, you know, you have to prioritize features, and this was just one of the
lower
features
ones.
That got left out.
So maybe 2.0.
Maybe 2.0.
All right. Well, there you have it, folks. Everybody check out Bluesmart. Get Bluesmart on Twitter, bluesmart.com. I'm going to order one. I'm going to be a pretty tough customer. I want to see what it's like. I think you should offer – this is my thing. Okay, here's something that I think I could punch it up. Offer three different battery sizes. You know, normal, mm-hmm. large, and ridiculous. And call it that. Normal, which is what you have now. Large and ridiculous. And what ridiculous does is ridiculous lets you plug in your laptop. So you actually put – what's the plug that – you know, like a three-prong, 110. Mm-hmm. So put a 110 volt in this jammy. That would be the ultimate for a real business traveler to be able to plug your laptop into here. OMG. How much would that cost extra? $100?
So we are working on compatibility with laptops as well. So yeah, for sure.
So you think you could put a MagSafe in here?
Yeah.
Have to pay a royalty to
so
Apple.
So we're doing some research about the kind of the licensing agreement that would be required, but we know it's feasible.
You probably have to give them like $25. I bet you they would want a fortune.
It can be difficult, I think, to get those licenses. So,
how much would it cost to triple the battery? Battery's expensive. Triple the battery would be an extra 10, 20, 30 bucks.
No, I don't know the number off the top of my head, actually.
What is because that battery can't cost more than 20 bucks.
Right.
So if you triple it, maybe 60 bucks. You have to offer a triple battery. I'm telling you, the number one issue people have is battery. And if you got idiots like me, and it's 195 with the regular, and you have like, you know, 250 and 300 and 350, like multiple, you're going to get into like literally 10%. Because this is what happened with Tesla. They offered a small, medium, large. Mm-hmm. Literally nobody offered the small. They got rid of it. And the small was what everybody had on the existing EVs, like, you know, 150 miles. But when it came to Tesla, because there were two other options, nobody ever ordered it. So they just discontinued that. And they only allowed you to buy medium and large.
Yeah.
And now they're going to come out with a jumbo, I heard. It's going to be amazing. All right, listen, continued success. Everybody follow _B Chen. And thanks again to WeWork for hosting us here, for doing the show. What a great host WeWork has been to the show, and we really do appreciate that. See you next time. Hey, everybody, it's Jason Calacanis, and this is Startup Basics, brought to you by my friends at WSGR, you know, the famous law firm, Wilson Sonsini. And the way we came up with this idea was we were sitting having coffee, and we're talking about two of our shared passions, which is how do we help startups more? And we thought about all these folks who are coming into the industry now, inspired by seeing all these great successes, and we very simply said to ourselves, let's try one more time to answer those very basic questions people have. And with startups, you know, you hear the same questions over and over again, and it changes over time. So what was true when I was starting in the internet business in 93 and 94 was very different than 99 and 2000. It changed radically in 2004, and it's changed again in 2014. So I've seen these questions come up over two decades in my career, investing in 70 companies, building three or four, and hosting podcasts for 500 episodes or so, and doing interviews with founders. So this question is one that you've heard a million times, which is, how do I find a co-founder? And so I want to just back up from the question of how do I find a co-founder to why do you need a co-founder? What is the role of a co-founder? Why do people feel like success could be greater with a co-founder? Well, in the beginning, when you're starting a company, if you have two people working on it for free, you're going to get twice as much work done. And you have two people who are hugely vested in making it succeed. In other words, Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs, Larry Page and Sergey Brin both have everything at stake in building that company. So we've had this sort of myth in our industry of, you know, co-founders is how it's done. Now, it doesn't always work that way. Sometimes you have multiple people on the team. Sometimes you have one person on the team and a couple of bit players. The reason most people think that you should have a co-founder, I believe, is because they've seen so many examples of successful companies with them. Why do you need a co-founder? It can be very lonely to be a startup founder. It's very isolating because you hire a bunch of intelligent people. They come to you with how the business is going every day, hopefully. And they bring you sometimes all the good news because people don't want to go to their boss with bad news. And so I see this all the time. People come to me, oh, boss, this is going great. This is going great. Oh, the launch festival has this many people, this. And I have to stop and say, hey, what's the bad news, right? Now, what happens over time is you hire all, if you're a single co-founder, you hire all these smart people. They bring you the problems they can't solve. If you've trained them correctly and created the right culture, that they bring you problems, which is a whole nother subject, which we'll do in another Startup Basics. But then you have your board. And a lot of times the board's invested their money in your company, in which case, if things are really problematic, I see a lot of founders are scared to tell the board because they don't want to get fired or they want to put their best foot forward. And they don't want to tell the team because they don't want the team to think like, oh my God, everything's out of control. I might need to leave this company. When you have a co-founder, you can sit there, drink beers and say, wow, we are a moment away from going out of business, or this doesn't seem like it's working, and have like a real honest co-founder discussion. And so that loneliness and that ability to vibe with somebody who is on equal footing with you is really valuable. So I had that in my second company, which was called Weblogs Inc., where Brian Alvey, who was an employee of mine at the previous company, Silicon Valley Reporter, became my partner on Weblogs Inc., which was a great, great success for us. Now, you need to have a complementary skill set when you're doing co-founders, or hopefully you do. What's complementary? One person likes to go out and speak at conferences. One person likes to stay home and work on the product. One person likes to do sales calls. One person likes to do hiring. Another person likes to raise money. The other person likes to build the deck. It's not always going to be perfect, but if you have two extroverted business people, they're going to be fighting for the stage and who gets to do, you know, the Fast Company interview versus who gets to do the New York Times interview. And I see that frequently. And that is always problematic. If you have two technical people, neither of them may want to do any of the press. Neither of them may want to do the fundraising. They may just, you know, want to build the product together. So that can be pretty complementary. But complementary skill sets are important. But most important is, how many years have you worked together or known each other? The larger the number of years you've worked together and or gone to school together and known each other as friends, the greater the chance of success. So as far as I'm concerned, if you haven't known the person for over a year or two and you haven't worked with them, becoming co-founders, you need to be prepared for it not working out. Just like if you were to marry your college, you know, sweetheart who you lived with for 2 years and you dated in college and, you know, he was really cute and you spent a lot of time together, whatever it is, you know, getting married after 8 years together, you might have a greater chance of success and having lived together and had a lot of mutual experiences. If you just met them on OkCupid or Tinder in the last 3 months, you might not want to rush into that marriage, right? And people do talk about being co-founders as a marriage for good reason, because your fates are tied. And the only way to unwind those is through legal, uncomfortable breakup proceedings, just like a marriage, right? Like a divorce. The divorces at startups are brutal, because you could have people just disagree and the business is doing great. And then one person has vested a portion of the shares, the other person hasn't. And you get this crazy, you know, people being kicked out and moved up and bored drama, which if you read the Twitter book, it's filled with Hatching Twitter. By Nicholas Bolton. So I think if you haven't actually known each other for a long time, I would not become co-founders. I think it's a mistake, to be totally honest. If you have known each other for a long time, by all means, give it a shot. And you have to have this discussion, which is, we're going to be co-founders. We're both going to vest our shares over 4 years. And you may sometimes vest the first year because you've been working on it for a year and you convince your VCs or investors to do that. For those of you who don't know what vesting is, it means, if we were partners on the company and we gave 20% to an investor and we gave 15% to the employees and there were 65% less, and we gave 5% to a key employee, let's say we had 60 points left. We each have 30 points, right? Jason and Brian at Weblogs Inc. We have to vest that over 4 years, which means we're going to get about 7.5%, or exactly 7.5% every year. So if after a year you decide, hey, the business needs Jason, not Brian, or Brian, not Jason, and Brian or Jason need to go,
wow, that person might lose 75% of their stock options, which means there has to be a negotiation that occurs because the board can unilaterally fire them, right? If they have the voting power, a founder could be voted out. And that's where that board dynamic comes in. Now, if it gets to that point, things are in total disarray and the company might not be worth anything. But it does happen sometimes that the company's worth a heck of a lot and this happens. And then that's when people hire lawyers. And typically what would happen is in that situation, let's say you had two people with 30%, one had vested, let's say 10%, one third of their shares. The board might say, okay, we'll let you vest another 5 points in the business over the next year as a board member or as a consultant. They'll come to some reasonable negotiation to keep the co-founders happy. But it is more fun to win together. Now, if you're older and you've got two or three startups under your belt, I don't think it's a good idea to have a co-founder unless you absolutely love working with that person and it's what you want to do. Why? It doesn't make sense on an equity cap table with all these talented people out there to give away half at the start if you're a Mark Pincus type, right? Or you're whoever, you know, Jack from Twitter or Evan Williams with Medium. You see those folks tend to go out on their own and then they hire their founding team, as it were. So hiring a founding team means you're giving them, you know, half a point, 2 points, 3 points, 5 points maybe, but not half of all your equity. And that's fairer to you and to everybody. If you're not technical and you're looking for a technical co-founder, we see that a lot. I think you need to really have a sugar ton of value. I was about to use the S word. Sugar ton of value if you are the non-technical co-founder. So I am a non-technical I know technology very well, but I'm not a coder, right? And so somewhere along the lines, basically because of Y Combinator and Techstars, people got very obsessed with technical founders, especially because of Zuckerberg's success as well. So the idea that, you know, a founder who's technical is, you know, very important and more important, it's a bit of a fallacy, but it does reduce the risk in the early stages when, you know, if you lose developers and it's hard to find developers, the product could get lost. So if you're a non-technical founder, you need to have some very strong skills. Raising money, getting press, hiring world-class people, maybe designing the product, being a product designer, maybe sales and getting partnerships and deals. So I've seen all those kind of co-founders out there. Peter Pham, who did Color.com and a couple of other companies, he's just known as a deal maker, an incredible deal machine. So he's a great co-founder to have if you had a technology, if you had a company and you were a technical co-founder. And so let's move on to what some people who've been on my program have said about this very issue. First up, we're going to hear a clip from Jerry Colonna, and this is really about difficult situations. Let's play the clip. Number five, avoiding difficult, fearful, or challenging situations, people, or conversations.
Well, it's like a client I had who took 2 years to fire his co-founder. 2 years.
Two.
2 years.
Not one, two.
2 years.
Not one, 2 months, 2 years.
Right, 2 years to fire. Everybody knew, including both parties, but nobody dealt with it.
So they let him vest for 2 years.
Forget about the vesting. You immediately go to that. Think about the damage that does.
Oh, of course,
organization.
Yeah.
Organization grew, hundreds of people, and there's the, you know, what's Johnny doing over in the corner?
Nothing.
Nothing.
We've given him busy work.
But we're not talking about it, and we're not dealing with it.
Yeah, so this is an absolutely fantastic, anecdote from Jerry Colonna of exactly how bad it can be, because keeping people in a startup who are not actually productive, it leads to this really bad situation where people resent it. And then they lose faith in the management. So I've had this problem in the past where I have not acted quick enough. And when I was in my younger years, I used to always think I could work with somebody. I used to always think like, you know, I'm a psychology major and I know how to get in people's heads. So if this person's not performing at the great level, I will try to, you know, just be the master motivator coach, you know, Phil Jackson from the Lakers or Pat Riley from the Knicks and Miami Heat. I'll get in their head. It never works because it takes so much time. Even if you are able to get to them and change them, they might wind up resenting you because they feel like you're like too involved in their head. And so the best thing to do is to cut it off quick and to make sure people know, listen, it's not working out. It's nobody's fault necessarily. This happens all the time. This company needs to have a clear direction. And so like two pilots trying to pilot the same plane will not result in anything but death and despair and crashes and loss of life and, you know, all kinds of valuable things. You need to have one pilot in that seat. Fine to have co-pilots, but gosh, you know, get rid of the co-founder if it's not working out, and treat them well. That's the other thing. You know, this is something, you know, I used to get when I was younger, a little resentful, like when firing people, and I was just like, God, this person didn't do a good enough job for the last 4 weeks. And, you know, like, oh, we got to fire them with prejudice, you know, like we have to send a message. And I got older and I was like, you know what? It's part of startups. You're going to hire people, they're not going to be productive. And then you're going to hire other people, and they're going to be wildly productive. Like, I'm so blessed with the team I have at Launch or Inside right now. They're all wildly productive. So more than probably I pay them for. They're just like driven people. They put in a lot of extra time. So if you have somebody who's a dud, the way I look at it now is I got four other people for every dud or nine other people for every dud who are crushing it and just paying huge dividends for our shareholders. I'm not going to sweat it. I'm not going to sweat the person who we wasted 8 weeks of salary on or 8 months of salary on even. I'll just cut my losses and move on and not have that, you know, in my headspace. All right. And we have one more clip from Mr. Mark Suster. Can we play that? What do you think is the cause of most fighting between co-founders?
Well, let's start with a few basic things, which is often co-founders don't know each other that well when they start.
Right.
Even the ones who know each other well, let's say it's a 10-year journey or a 7-year journey. Mm-hmm. And let's say you all start when you're 29.
Yep.
29 to 36, what happens? People fall in love.
Yeah.
People get married.
Babies.
People have a baby. You find out, and all of this has happened to me in experiences, you find people who start drinking too much. Mm-hmm. You find depression.
Uh-huh.
You find people who don't come into the office as much.
Mm-hmm.
And you find some people who have really high risk tolerance. I want to build a $1 billion company. And other people who think, no, I want to be conservative. If I could make $2 million, that would change my life. So your incentives are not always aligned.
I don't believe in this co-founder nonsense. I think it could be self-founders.
But do you know that I'm the most public guy on this topic?
No.
I wrote a blog post, you should read it, called The Co-Founder Mythology. I went to Stanford and I delivered a speech in the heart
You're
of
kidding.
Silicon
we
Valley
think the same about
called
this.
The Co-Founder Mythology. And what I argue is, here's my argument, Jason, real quickly, I'm sorry,
is that— No, I want to hear it.
You should hire your co-founders. And here's what I mean.
That's what I do.
If you start with 100%,
yeah,
and let's say you raise capital and give away 20% to your capital—
Yeah, 50 left.
You can do whatever you want. You can bring in someone for 3%, 5%, 10%,
sure.
40%, right? It's up to you, but you're still in charge. You still control voting. You should treat them like a founder. Be open with your financials and how much equity you have, how much they have.
Sure.
Involve them in decision making. But if you ever fall out of love, you have a prenup.
Right.
Right? And
investing of stock.
The other thing I should tell you is, I talk to incredibly talented people who are afraid of taking risks. They don't manifest that in their own mind that way, but they will gladly join a company for 2% that has been de-risked, for 1% that has been de-risked.
So and de-risked I say, means
you've
like,
raised a little capital, you've got the idea, you've got the business plan, the website, the prototype, whatever. So if I go to you and say, you know what, Jason, I've decided to give you 10%.
Mm.
I mean, fuck me. Who gives 10% to anybody, right? It doesn't happen.
Right.
It's a myth if you think it happens. But if you go in and you own the majority of the company to begin with, you have that flexibility.
So there you have it. Just, you know, two legendary investors and now one's a coach who were on This Week in Startups and really addressed that issue head on. You got some good information to get started here. Open communication, take the relationship, the co-founder relationship, dead serious, and invest in it. As I tell people, the teams that break bread more often than the teams that don't build better products and they last longer. So taking retreats, having dinners, taking people out to lunch, all that stuff seems superfluous at times. And I used to actually be a little hardcore about that. Like, why are we wasting time on this kind of stuff? Why are we wasting money on this stuff? Then I realized, hey, wait, if I was the person working at that company, it would feel really special for me to be able to have the founder's time at a dinner or at a lunch or to do an offsite, right? It's that attention and that caring to having a deeper bond with everybody on the team that matters. And do that if you're co-founders. Make sure you've got plenty of time on the calendar together on a regular basis. Some additional resources for you, founderdating.com, which is like speed dating for it, cofounderslab.com, and accelerators like Techstars really specialize in this. In fact, David Cohen, brilliant accelerator creator, has a program where people can come in and be just a Techstar is Techstar. You're just a great developer, a great marketer. You go there, you hang out, and you see the teams building stuff, and you go, I want to be part of that team. And then that team says, we want that guy or that gal on our team. And they make you an offer, and so you can join these accelerators sometimes just as a gunslinger. Your skills matter. Make sure you have great skills in life. And thank you to my friends at Wilson Sonsini for partnering with me on this very important series. We hope that this really helps founders be prepared for the incredibly hard yet exciting journey they're going to be on building their startup. We'll see you next time.